As most of us try to put COVID-19 in the rearview mirror, the arrival of some new contagion is the last thing anyone wants. Then along comes monkeypox. So let's find out what risks it poses. Joining us now in Mississauga, Ontario, Dr. Zain Chagla. He is an infectious disease physician at St. Joseph's Healthcare Hamilton and associate professor of medicine at McMaster University. Welcome to the program.
Hi, thanks for having me.
All right, I am not an infectious disease specialist, neither is the wider public, although many may think so after 2 years of a pandemic. So let's start with the basics. What is the monkeypox virus?
So this is a DNA virus, very different than COVID-19. That's an RNA virus. It very closely related to the virus that causes smallpox within the same family. This has been described in the 1970s in monkeys, which is derivative of the name, but more recently has been shown to be circulating in rodents, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, West and Central Africa, where there's been sporadic cases and actually a significant rise in cases over the last 10 years that have been largely from interactions with rodents in those communities and then coming back into households with limited spread. There have been a few events of transmission that's occurred outside of West and Central Africa. There was an outbreak in 2003 associated with some rodents that were actually imported from the Gambia and other West African nations. And then more recently, we've seen a few events associated with travelers from an outbreak that's been occurring in Nigeria. Over the last month and a half, though, there has been now a new set of descriptions amongst individuals acquiring monkeypox without those epidemiologic and travel links to Central and West Africa, which has been actually the largest event that's occurred in history of monkeypox outside of those endemic settings.
Do we have a sense of what sort of caused these most recent outbreaks in countries that, you know, smallpox has been eradicated for many years?
Yeah, I mean, it's unclear. Part of it and what's happening in West and Central Africa now is the, you know, so-called lack of immunity to smallpox, which is leading to a vulnerable population. And we see cases in places like the Democratic Republic of Congo higher than they've ever been before. But, you know, there is probably some set of events that occurred either within West and Central Africa or with people from that region in another area of the world that then transmitted to a different network of individuals, which is now transmitting in other networks of individuals all over the world. And, you know, I think the other part is the recognition that this was, you know, something that was transmitted and, you know, a number of individuals that were having atypical symptoms that didn't fit into a box now is starting to be recognized as people with monkeypox endemically in places like Portugal, UK, the EU, Canada, and the United States, where they may have been unfortunately attributed to other symptoms and not necessarily treated as a monkeypox case.
All right, so let's talk about transmission. You talk about travel. Is this through contact? Is this airborne? How exactly can someone get monkeypox?
Right now, you know, from what's described, most of the transmission is short range and really is intimate close contact. So skin to skin contact and contact with open sores of individuals, especially as they're going through that pox phase where the virus is incredibly present within those lesions. We do see respiratory spread, and it is a potential mechanism. We see people in their respiratory tracts have virus. And so, you know, the droplet and aerosol spread is possible. And certainly in healthcare settings, for example, it's a part of the way we manage cases in that sense. But again, many of the cases we're seeing are people with very close and intimate contact with primary cases, suggesting that, again, that skin to skin or very, very prolonged respiratory contact are the major mechanisms of spread here.
You talked about the open sores. What other symptoms should people be looking out for that would help identify that to monkeypox?
So the incubation period, so after being exposed to develop symptoms, is about 5 to up to 20 days, most people within a week or two. There's about 1 to 5 days of just feeling unwell, flu-like, you know, could be mixed up with another infection. And then there's the appearance of the characteristic rash. And so these often start out kind of as flat red areas that then start getting raised and then fluid filled and turn into kind of pustules, which then cause ulcerations in the skin. These can be anywhere over the body. You know, the typical classic descriptions from West and Central Africa are the face and then involving the trunk afterwards. But certainly in this this set of individuals that we're seeing, the genital areas, so in the mouth, around the lips, around the penis, and around other genital areas have been also described and actually quite predominant among some of the individuals that have been described.
All right, I want to talk about treatment and the tools at our disposal. A little bit different, of course, than COVID-19 because we had to act fast. I understand with smallpox vaccine, there is, you know, there is some research there and there's some ways to tackle it. What are the sort of approaches there?
Yeah, so number one, you know, because a lot of people are symptomatic, and so it's, you know, a little bit easier to identify cases as compared to COVID-19. Case and contact management is still a really appropriate intervention that if you find cases, you look back at their contacts, you're able to isolate contacts, you can largely limit spread in that context. The fact that we have vaccines, and so smallpox vaccines are the oldest vaccines that we have. In fact, the prototype for vaccines, the word vaccinia comes from cowpox, which is the derivative of vaccine. But with the newer generations of smallpox vaccines, which are much, you know, easy to acquire and easier to administer, could be given to individuals after exposure, which then may reduce spread ongoing to further individuals and so-called ring vaccination to make sure that the contacts of a case are immune and are less likely to transmit outside of that. And also can be used in higher risk individuals like healthcare workers, those who work in the lab, et cetera. And then there is a treatment available, a drug called tecovirimat or Mpox, Tpox, which has effects on smallpox, which likely has in vitro effects on monkeypox. But thankfully, again, you know, the vast majority of cases that are being described in this new outbreak that's been seen over the last month and a half have been mild, with very, very few requiring hospitalizations, even those, you know, mainly for social reasons or to get to a diagnosis a bit quicker.
Is it fair to say that this is not a deadly strain of monkeypox?
Yeah, the clade that's been noticed here genetically is linked to the West African clade, which, you know, had a mortality rate of 3%, which was described in West Africa. Now, you know, we have to take that very differently in the context of what's happening now. You know, the descriptions in West Africa were also of people that, you know, didn't necessarily seek medical attention, with high levels of malnutrition, with high levels of poorly treated chronic diseases, high levels of HIV, and so mortalities may appear higher. Again, the global experience we've had now of nearly 1,300 cases being described to this point, you know, the vast majority have had outcomes where they've never needed to be hospitalized, or hospitalization has only been a part of just making the diagnosis or helping with isolation, which, you know, hopefully pretends to a fairly good prognosis in most individuals. And again, largely a disease that will likely be outside of hospitals than within hospitals.
All right. So let's talk about the numbers here in Canada. A disproportionate number of cases of monkeypox have shown up in gay and bisexual men, as well as men who have sex with men. Do we have a sense of why that is the case?
Yeah, it's not totally clear. This may be dealing with the networks of people that were first a part of that whatever event occurred that led to transmission outside of West and Central Africa. There is some data coming out from Eurosurveillance. Again, whether or not it's that close intimate contact that may occur during sex, or is it actually from body fluids? There's some data from Italy suggesting that male body fluids, for example, may also have some degree of viral replication. And we have seen this with other diseases like Zika and Ebola, where genital fluids may also be a source of infection. But, you know, certainly we have to recognize that it is with within these networks. And part of the solutions for disease control are, you know, creating non-stigmatizing approaches, really partnering with organizations that represent these communities, providers that represent these communities, and offering interventions as partnerships with these communities. Not necessarily excluding the other communities from the need for diagnosis and monitoring, but really making sure that these communities are supported as part of their efforts to mitigate the disease.
I want to pick up on that notion of stigma. You know, monkeypox is very different from HIV and AIDS, but as the headlines link the disease to outbreaks among men who have sex with men, are there bigger concerns that this community once again will be singled out and stigmatized?
Yeah, I mean, hopefully, and there's been an incredible amount of progress from HIV in these populations, right? And again, putting gay and bi men who have sex with men really upfront in advocacy, really upfront in partnerships with the health community, you know, coming up with messaging that's non-stigmatizing but also targeted towards communities is still important, right? We can recognize that the highest risk community right now is gay and bi men who have sex with men, and we can provide partnerships in non-stigmatizing ways, advocate, give resources to those communities in order to make sure that men are educated and have access to testing, vaccinations, and other preventative efforts needed. You know, I think we've learned a lot from HIV to make sure that we can do this in a way that supports communities in a non-stigmatizing way, but it really, again, involves partnerships more than anything else. And these partnerships have to be in Toronto, but they have to be in smaller cities as well across the province and the country.
Now, you've mentioned HIV. We've obviously learned from that. We've also learned from COVID-19 how fast we have to act. What lessons from this pandemic can we apply to monkeypox?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, with parallels to HIV, when it started showing up in North America, you know, there had been decades of transmission that had been occurring in sub-Saharan Africa. And, you know, with COVID, you know, similarly, you know, the burden of disease in the developing and low-income world was directly correlated to this virus's evolution, its trajectory throughout the world. And so, you know, I think we have to recognize this is a global health threat. You know, the rise of infectious diseases with climate change, with populations that are encroaching in animal spaces more and more, and the fact that we're such a globalized population where someone can get on a flight anywhere around the world within 24 hours, you know, really makes us cognizant of our global health position and our need to support communities and surveillance and efforts. There's been ongoing transmission of monkeypox in Nigeria and in the Democratic Republic of Congo that's been unnoticed to the community outside of those regions in the Western world for years. And, you know, I think we are paying the price for this, right? We recognize there was an infectious disease threat that could have come on a plane any time over the last decade, but we're seeing what happens when it finally does make it out. And it may be, you know, that people suffer from it. So, you know, part of our efforts moving forward outside of this pandemic is recognizing global health is a global community, is partnerships with high and low income countries, is supporting research and practice in high and low income countries, and that knowledge collaboration and knowledge partnership that we are a global community, that health across both animal and human species is important and is going to be a very fundamental investment moving forward for the entirety of our world.
Really great point, but I do have to ask this question. You know, it's been 2 years people have been living with COVID-19. You know, as a public, as an infectious disease specialist and working in public health, are you concerned at how receptive people will be and the public will be to having to deal with news about another virus?
Yeah, I mean, look, we've had, in the last two decades, we've had SARS-CoV-1, we've had Middle Eastern respiratory syndrome, we've had Zika, we've had Ebola, we've had avian influenza or swine influenza in 2009, and we've had SARS-CoV-2. You know, this is not a pace that's slowing down, right? We are a globalized society and we have to embrace this. At the same time, I think this does start the discussion, especially in dealing with COVID in the current day, about really making sure that positive, non-stigmatizing, non-discriminatory efforts are put forward first and foremost, and that we embrace communities in a positive public health approach. We need the public as a stakeholder as we move forward in pandemics, this one and the next one and the next one after that. And we do have to think about the consequences of more punitive measures again, they may lose public trust as we need the public back to help deal with other emerging infectious disease threats. So, you know, I think we skate on very delicate ice in terms of what we deal with COVID, but at the same time, the public is a part of our stakeholder for the emergence of infectious diseases, and we have to make sure we're looking at not only the short game, but the long game in terms of engagement.
Dr. Zain Chagla, appreciate your insights. Thank you so much for joining us on the program.
No problem. All the best.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.